of the most beautiful people on the face of the planet. And you look like you got something to be excited about.
Amen.
Look like you got joy this morning. Amen. How many glad you say that? Times such as this, we're glad that we're saved. We're living in the most evil and wicked time that's ever been. And I tell you, as ever a child of God, I ought to be thankful and glad that we're ready to go at any moment. And a trump sound, the notice of the sound of the trumpet and the victory shout, it's the time now. It's getting ready to happen. I really believe that. We're seeing things line up right now. I really believe the church is getting ready to take a flight. Hallelujah. And somebody said, well, my ticket's punched. Well, my ticket's not punched, but it was paid for.
Amen.
By the blood of Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. Somebody said, well, I got my bags packed. I ain't packing my bags. I ain't taking nothing with me. I'm leaving it all behind when I leave here. Every trouble, every storm, every mountain, every care. I'm leaving it all behind. And I'm going to a city. Hallelujah, that's far beyond compare. A city where there be no more suffering, no more pain, no more sickness. John said the former things are passed away. And I'm looking forward to going to that place. We'll never know trouble again.
That's right.
Amen.
We'll never have leaders that trying to push their ungodly ways on us ever again.
Right.
We'll never see school shootings ever again.
Right.
We'll never see church shootings ever again. I'm talking about a place where there's perfection, where there's beauty, where there's no sin. Hallelujah.
Right.
And I'm looking forward to that going. That John said that city had 12 gates. There were 3 in the north, 3 in the south, 3 in the east, 3 in the west, 12 foundations of that city.
Yes.
It was 1,500 miles square. Hallelujah. 1,500 miles that way, 1,500 miles that way. Hallelujah. It had no need for the sun or the moon, for the light of the city is Jesus Christ. I've often thought about all of those pearls and diamonds and jewels, how beautiful they'll glow and all that gold. But you think of the reflection of the glory of the Son of God, Jesus Christ, and all of those pearls just radiating that beauty that's shining there, Jesus Christ. I'm telling you something. I'm glad I'm going to that city, aren't you? I'm glad hell's not going to be my home. Hallelujah. I'm going to heaven someday. Glory to God. And I'm thankful until then. We have a place we can assemble together with the saints of God. I'm glad I don't have to come to a funeral service this morning.
Amen.
I'm glad I can come and assemble together with a group of excited people that ain't worried about trying to get out of here at 12 o'clock.
Amen.
They ain't worried about everything else going on. They ain't got their minds on every word else. But people that are hungry and starving for an outpouring of the Holy Ghost and power. That's what we're here for today. Amen. We're not here to be seen or to show off anything. But we're here that we may pull up to the table of the King and feast on that heavenly manna that comes down from God. That we may leave here grown and equipped in the power of the Holy Ghost. I'm telling you, we need it today. The church needs revival. Hallelujah. Good to see you here today, all the visitors. We welcome you. You're not visiting. You're not visitors, but you're here. We're part of the family of God.
That's
it doesn't
right.
matter where you come from. The Bible tells me there's no Baptist, there's no Methodist, no Presbyterian.
Right.
There's only one Lord, one faith, one baptism. And I'm telling you today, it's all about the Word of God.
Yeah.
I believe in the whole book. I believe in the truth, nothing but the truth, the whole truth.
Right.
And I believe there's one God, one mediator between God and man, Jesus Christ. I'm telling you, I believe in God the Father, I believe in God the Son, I believe in God the Holy Spirit. All three of these in one. Glory to God. And I'm thankful today that I know Jesus and He knows me. I'm glad I've been born again. I'm glad I'm saved. I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God and the salvation that everyone believes. Everyone that believes, let me tell you something today. Too many Christians are ashamed. It's easy when you get into a highfalutin Holy Ghost meeting like here to lift up hands and praise the Lord. But then you get outside these doors and you see people out there and you just want to get up with them and you want to start praising God. And you think, well, boy, these people out there, they look good in church. Surely I can pray. And then they get out there in the public and they're too ashamed to lift their hands, too afraid of what people might think, too afraid of what people might say. Honey, we've gotten past that point. Glory to God. It don't matter what people say. It don't matter what people think. Hallelujah. I got a right to praise Him today. I got a right to shout. I got a right to lift up holy hands. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Glory to God. I've learned the more you talk about the Lord, the more the devil wants to stay away.
Amen.
Glory to God. Boy, I feel good this morning. Hallelujah. We better move on. We got a lot going on today, but what to say tonight? Boy, begins our Bible school, and I'm looking for it. How many is excited about Vacation Bible School? Begins tonight, runs through Friday night from 6 o'clock to 8:30. Bring your children, bring your kids, bring your grandchildren. Not only that, there'll be something all the way up to the adults. Come on out and be with us. We're going to have a great time this week. Sister Haley, Brother Jacob, they've been working hard. Others, Marlon over here, they've been working hard. And others have been working, and we're just looking for a phenomenal week in the Lord. Souls to be saved, lives to be changed and touched. And I'm telling you, God wants to do it in the hour we're living in right now.
Amen.
I know if you believe that by the response, so that's all right. God will honor that belief of a few. Hallelujah. But I'm telling you, God's going to do great, mighty things this week. That begins tonight from 6 o'clock to 8:30. Come out, be with us every night. It's going to be a great time in the Lord. This afternoon at 3 o'clock, we'll be over at, it's called Breakthrough Ministries, over here next to the Mexican restaurant in Edmonton, and Brother Adam Burton is the pastor, and there are several other pastors that will be coming and praying over certain things. And my responsibility, I was asked to pray over the nation, and I said I sure will. And so this is going to be a call to prayer. Everybody's invited to come out and be with us at 3 o'clock. I told him, I said, well, we're having Bible school starts at 6 o'clock. He said, well, I'll make sure that all you all, the folks at Grace Union, that we'll get you out of there quick so you can get back. So everybody come that can come at 3 o'clock, and we're honored to be a part of that. And June the 14th, I'll be preaching at the Lighthouse Church in Horse Cave at 6 o'clock on that Tuesday night. And come out and be with us. If you can't be with us, be in prayer for us. We're going to have a great time, Lord. It's been a while since we've been down there. And you know, I'm just going in the power of the Holy Ghost and with the Word of God.
Amen.
And I want to see things happen. Hallelujah. I want to see things happen today. I want to see things happen in this church. I want to see lives changed and touched. I want to see folks built up, lifted up in the power of His might. My friend, today we're living in a time, if you don't get in this, a hold of this power from on high, if you don't get a hold of this, tap into it, we're heading into a time such as you've never seen before. And you're going to have a holy boldness. You're going to have that same power the early church had. Anybody tells you that power don't exist today and went out with the early church, let me tell you, that's a lie straight from the devil.
Amen.
Because God wants us to have that same power, that same spirit that fell on that day of Pentecost and worked with the early church where they saw signs, wonders, and miracles, is the exact same power God desires for the church today to have. And we better not discredit that power. My friend, if you think you're going to get along in this life in your own ability, in your own way, sooner or later, let me tell you, you're going to find out real quick that you can't make it without that great power.
Amen.
But my friend, let me tell you this morning, if you'll make that mind up and your decision that, Lord, I need all of you that I can get, God can work through you and work with you in a mighty way. And the church needs this power today. Grace Union needs this power. Every church that's assembled today needs this power. I don't care if you come out of the seminaries. I don't care if you come out of denomination programs. Let me tell you something. You can have all of those great things and great programs, but honey, if you ain't got the power, I'm talking about the genuine power of the Holy Ghost, you ain't got nothing.
Amen.
Glory to God. I don't care how beautiful the church looks, how great the people are. It takes the power of the Holy Spirit, that working of the Holy Spirit that changes lives, changes homes, changes nations, and shakes them. Hallelujah. And so praise God today. It's here.
Amen.
I said it's here.
Amen.
Glory to God. We just got to open our eyes to get everything else off our mind, put everything else out, and get our mind set on Jesus. Let's stand together this morning as we go to the Lord in prayer. Let's remember each other. Let's remember the lost. Remember the sick. Let's pray for the service today. Pray for this Bible school coming up tonight. Let's pray for one another. Let's pray that God would just send down that fire, that rain. Hallelujah. And you know, Ezekiel said, there shall be showers of blessing. And I believe today God's going to open up the heavens. You know, the man said, I see the cloud the size of a man's hand. He said, I hear the sound of abundance of rain. I hear the sound of abundance of rain. I hear the sound of abundance of rain. You need to get, reach out and get a hold to that. I hear the sound of abundance of rain. Glory to God. Today you can make up your mind to get in it or not, but I've made up my mind. I'm going to get in the flow of the Holy Spirit. I'm going to get in the river. Glory to God. And wherever the river flows, that's where I want to go. Hallelujah. And every place that river flows, everything that's dead that river touches is going to give life. And I declare it in this place today in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Every demonic spirit has to go. Every power of darkness has to go. Satan and his plan has to go. Hallelujah. All the hell trembles at the name of Jesus. Father, we come before you this morning in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank you and praise you for another beautiful, blessed day that you blessed us with. And God, we send up our thanksgiving to you, knowing that, Lord, you are the absolute source of everything that we have. Everything that we're blessed with, God, we didn't attain it on our own merit. But God, you supplied it and you provided. And we echo the words the Apostle Paul said, that my God shall supply all of our needs according to your riches and glory by Christ Jesus. And Lord, today we recognize you in all of your holiness, all of your righteousness, knowing God, that man has nothing. Lord, when we stand before you outside of the garment of righteousness that you have placed upon us, the moment that we were saved, Lord, the garment of your Son Jesus Christ that we're clothed with. And God, we thank you today, Lord, that you're such a good God. You're merciful, you're gracious, you're long-suffering, you're patient with us. And Lord, we're so thankful, God, for that unmerited favor that you placed upon us, God, knowing that we're not saved by our works, Lord, lest any man should boast, but God, that we're saved by your grace through our faith in that finished work at Calvary. And Lord, today we thank you for allowing us to gather in this place today and assemble together as the family of God, as the household of faith, Lord. And God, we're so thankful today that we're your heirs and we're joint heirs with your Son, Jesus. And Lord, we count it a privilege. Lord, as many as received you, that you gave us power and authority to become your children, your sons, and your daughters. And Lord, today we're thankful that in that Lamb's Book of Life, Lord, names are being written. And saved and born again. And Lord, today we ask you in this place, if there's any here that's never been saved, never had that born again experience, I pray right now, Lord, the convicting power of the Holy Ghost, Lord, would just wrap around them, God. And Lord, that you would send that conviction upon their heart and life to make them realize, Lord, of their guiltiness before you and their condemnation, but that God, through their faith, they can call out upon your mighty name and be delivered and set free and saved. And Lord, all of that guilt and condemnation can be lifted off of them, God, and they can leave this place born again, a brand new person. Lord, today we ask you to touch those that are sick in body, that your divine healing would move upon them, those that are battling infirmities and diseases, God. I pray in Jesus' name, Lord, and Lord, you would minister healing to their lives. And God, I pray for those that are, Lord, have homes that are torn to pieces, God, and families that are torn to pieces. I pray, God, that, Lord, your mighty power would move upon them. And Lord, that you would restore their home, God. And Lord, today we ask you to touch our nation, touch our leaders, God. I pray, Lord, today that you would move upon their lives. And God, if they won't turn to you, I pray that, God, like you used the wicked kings of old, that, God, you would work in their minds, that, Lord, that you would give the church just a little window, that, God, we can win more souls to your kingdom before it's everlasting too late. And God, today we ask you, your mighty hand, to be upon this service. Move upon the singing, move upon the music, move upon the preaching of your word. And Lord, when that most important time, the part of the service that is most important, the invitation comes, I pray that lives can, Lord, come to you. Lord, as you said, come unto me, all ye that labor and heavy laden, and you said you would give us rest. And so today, God, move in the service in a mighty way. And we thank you for this church. Lord, bless this Bible school this week. Lord, we ask you that you guide us and direct us and lead us. We don't want to do one thing outside of your will, God. But Lord, we know if we're wholly surrendered to you, that God, you will use us mightily in these young people's lives. And we thank you and praise you for what you're going to do this week. Because we believe in faith, God, that great and mighty things are in store. And we ask all these things in Jesus' mighty name. And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. And amen. If you love him this morning, give him a big praise, would you? Hallelujah. We love him today. Remain standing if you can. Grab a song book. Let's sing to the Lord. Matter is not whether you can sing or not. Just make a joyful noise to it. Praise the Lord. Page 84. 84.
Come. Praise God.
good? Isn't he good, church? Isn't he good? Hallelujah. So Lord, you may be seated if you can. Hallelujah. I failed to mention a while ago, I wanted to say this. And yesterday I had the privilege of getting to meet the neighbor of the church over here, and I got to visit with him. And his name's easy to remember. His name's Joe. And I began to talk to him, and I'd asked him if he'd ever been saved, ever been born again. And he told me that his exact words was, "My terminology is probably not the same as your terminology." I said, "Sir, there's not but one terminology, and that's the Word of God." We began to talk, and I'm not so sure about his salvation, that he's saved. And I said all that to say this: I want the church to be praying for this man. Lives right next door to the church, but I'm believing God's going to get a hold of him. And I'm believing the power's going to flood out of this place and flow right over next door. I'm going to get a hold of this man. He asked me an odd question I've never been asked before. He said, "Do you heal people?" I said, "No." I said, "I don't have the ability to heal, nor does any man have the ability to heal. But I certainly know one who does. And his name is Jesus." And I don't know who he was talking about, but he said somebody from here had worked on his roof. He never did say who it was. And said their leg was messed up. And he said, you know, after he got done working with his roof, and his leg was a lot better. And I said, "You must have prayed for him, man." And he didn't quite understand what I was talking about. I want this church to be praying for this man. And I could just, when I talked with him and seen him, I could just see God had a great plan for this man and can use him mightily. But God's going to have to get a hold of his life, and he's going to have to allow God to get a hold of him. And when you grow up in certain doctrines and teachings, it's the hardest thing to get people out of those things. And so I want you to be praying for him. I want to say this morning, we're thankful for God answering prayers with Willie, with Lorraine, and Haskell's with us this morning. And he had his surgery done, and he's been a lot better. He's in church this morning. So we're praying to God to get a hold of him and touch his heart, touch his soul. Sister Becky, did you have something you wanted to testify?
It's been a rough time. And I know my church family knows everything. Because as a mother, as a father, never miss somebody so much in my life as I do that boy. I deal with this every day. There's not a day that I don't deal with the ache and the pain of missing that boy. Go to the cemetery. I come home. I can go to his house. It don't matter. I just miss him. I miss him so bad. See the devil sometimes working on me, telling me not to miss it. Don't miss it. God tells me to miss my baby. I know he does.
I want the church family right now that truly believes in the power of prayer. Praying, faith, believing. Nobody knows this kind of circumstance until you've gone through it. And the hurt, and people would say, "Well, you need to increase your faith." It don't have anything to do with faith. You know, it's something that hurts. And it takes the power of prayer to bring healing. And the power of God. And I want you to pray right now as we began to pray for Becky and Mike. Touch them. And Heavenly Father, we come before your holy presence right now as we feel led in our spirit to pray. God, only you can identify with the hurt that's in this family's home and their hearts. And Lord, there's no doubt that God, it'll always be there. But Lord, you said in your word that we can cast all of our cares upon you because you care for us. And Lord, you see the pain and the hurt in this family and their hearts. And God, we want to lift them up, Lord, to you right now. Forgive us, Lord, when we haven't prayed when we ought to and when we should. And Lord, as we're feeling that unction right now to pray, God, I pray that the power of heaven would come down in this home and this family. And all of heaven's hosts would encamp round about this family. And God, we know that there are times like this that, God, we become vulnerable to the enemy and Satan and his ways and his lies. But God, I pray your overshadowing protection upon this home and this family. And God, that you put a wall of fire round about them. And you'll shield them, Lord, from the wiles of the devil. And God, we ask you in Jesus' name, where there's pain, God, I pray for comfort. Where there's heart broke, Lord, I pray that, Lord, that heart would be mended, God. Lord, your word tells me you are the God of all comfort. And so, Lord, move upon this family and this home. This is a family that loves you, Lord. They worship you. They serve you. And we thank you and praise you for it, God, in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Now, you believe God will do it? You believe God is doing it? You believe it? Praise the Lord. We love you all night. Hallelujah. God is so good. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. We get our ushers to come forward and take up our Sunday morning tithes and all. I haven't got the program this morning from the church leadership and the schedule. But that's okay. God's got a program.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Praise God. Let's give to the Lord. Let's give to the Lord this morning as He has prospered us and as we are commanded to give. Giving is part of our worship. Don't hold back from the Lord. Don't keep from the Lord. You know, when you go back to Israel of old, they wouldn't pay their tithes to the Lord, which belonged to the Lord. A lot of people, you know, they'll hold back because they wonder how we're going to make it this week when we give to the Lord. Well, here's how you give. You give in faith, knowing that God will provide. Are you listening to me this morning? You give in faith, knowing that God will provide. And God said in Malachi that you've robbed me. Here's the thing people don't realize. The people of Israel, they held back from the Lord. You know what the Lord did? He put holes in their pockets. Don't make God have to put holes in your pockets. One way or the other, God's going to get your tithe.
Amen.
I said one way or the other, God's going to get your tithe. Now, I know people don't like when preachers start talking about money, but this money has nothing to do with going to me. It's going to God. And he belongs to Him anyway. So giving is part of your worship to the Lord, and it furthers the kingdom of God. Working the Great Commission, it costs money. It costs money.
Amen.
And so we've got bills to pay at the church. We've got things we have to do. And it's up to the people of God as we give to the work of the Lord. Hallelujah. Heavenly Father, we thank you for provision. God, we ask this morning that you'll bless the gift, bless the giver, multiply and increase it on every level. And Lord, we thank you this morning for all that you blessed us with. And we praise you and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. And amen.
Some rainbow, but thank God.
That's okay, because even when things go wrong or things are hard or they're bad, God is still with us, right? He never left. And he's going to be with us, and he's going to love us through it, and he's going to help us, right? Yeah. That's right. All right, let's pray this morning, okay? God, I thank you this morning, just for these kids, God. I thank you for this church, God. I thank you for just all the things that have already been said this morning, God. Just how everything just works together for your plan, God. I'm thankful that even when we have plans that don't always go our way or things that come up that maybe get in the way, that we know that the thing that your plan is always better than ours, and then you always know what's coming even before we do, before it comes. And I'm just thankful for the kids' excitement this morning, God, and just for their energy that they brought this morning, and just thankful that they are here with us this morning, God. We ask that you just be with them this week, God. We ask that you be with Bible school this week, and just let us step out of the way. God, we know that that good things are coming, and we are expecting and looking forward to those things. And we thank you for everything that you've done and everything that you're going to do for us. God, this morning we are just thankful, God, for your goodness and your love. We ask that you be with us as we leave here and come back tonight and bring everybody here safe. God, in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. JoJo, it's up here in the front.
Aren't you glad for these young folks this morning?
Amen.
Thank you.
That means we're going to guard the Lord. Amen. He don't know worries. No more troubles, no more cares. Hallelujah. If that don't make a child of God shout, I don't know what it'll take. Hallelujah. We got something to look forward to. Amen. We got a great expectation. The glorious appearing of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. While you got your Bibles, get ready to turn over. I just want to show this. This is what we have to expect tonight. A lot of coloring and crayon. That's a big crayon in it. Yeah. We've got so many talented, creative people in our church family. Amen. My wife said the other day, Jessica said, I've got to go to the dollar store and pick up some pool noodles. I thought, what in the world are you picking up pool noodles for? And so I never would have dreamed this is what that would turn out to be. Now, there's a lot of colors over there, but I wanted to show this to the church because this is my favorite color. A lot of people wonder why that I use a red handkerchief or like the color red. It's because it symbolizes the blood of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. So I'm thankful for these folks that are so talented. I hope I didn't turn that up. I'll get skin alive before tonight. And praise the Lord. Are you ready for the word of God this morning? Amen. Some of you are and some of you ain't. I'm going to preach it anyway. Let me ask one more time. How many ready for the word of God tonight? How many will declare I'm going to let it change my life? We got one already. He's ready to come on and get close to the fire. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Come on, buddy. I wish we had some adults if I had that much anyway. I'm going to get to Jesus and I have to crawl. Amen.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to the book of Luke this morning. Luke chapter 8. Luke chapter 8. I will say in all sincerity, I don't plan on holding you that very long. Praise God. Luke chapter 8. But I do want to minister the word that God has given us today. Luke chapter 8. And I want to go down. I want to begin reading in verse 35. Luke chapter 8, verse 35. Very familiar story in the Word of God. And I just believe God wants to break some chains and shackles in this place today. I said, I just believe God wants to break some chains and shackles in this place. Luke chapter 8, verse 35. The Bible says, then they went out to see what was done and came to Jesus and found the man out of whom the demons were departed, sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed and in his right mind. And they were afraid. They also which saw it told them by what means he that was possessed of the demons was healed. Then the whole multitude of the country of the Gadarenes round about besought Jesus to depart from them. For they were taken with great fear. And he went up into the ship and returned back again. Now the man out of whom the demons were departed besought Jesus, begged Jesus that he might be with him. But Jesus sent him away, saying, return to thy own house and show how great things God has done unto thee. And he went his way and published throughout the whole city how great things Jesus had done unto him. And I want to use for a subject for a few moments this morning, the new life. I said the brand new life, what Jesus can do for you, the new life. Hallelujah. Heavenly Father, we come before your holy presence once again this morning in Jesus' name. Lord, we thank you, God, today for moving in this service and moving upon the singing and moving upon the music. And Lord, the time of testifying and praying and giving. But God, as we come to this time, Lord, we declare your mighty word and this particular message that you've given us for this particular time today. God, I pray today that the Spirit of God, your Spirit, would move in such a mighty way in our midst. Lord, your word says that faith comes by hearing and hearing of your word. And Lord, how shall they hear except a preacher be sent? And Lord, declare and proclaim that mighty word. And Lord, I stand in that office today. Lord, I'm a weak vessel. I am unworthy, most unworthy of all that would stand. But God, you have called me, and you have sent me, Lord, to preach your gospel. And so today, Lord, I stand humble, Lord, knowing I have no ability within myself, but God, that my ability and the strength that I have only comes from you today. And so, God, I ask you for your anointing and your endowment today, that I may preach with such an unction, God, that I would not be seen or heard, but Lord, it would be as if you were yourself were here preaching. And God, that your word would go forth in power and demonstration of the Holy Spirit, and let it touch every heart, every life in this place. And God, I thank you and I praise you for it today. And we ask it all in Jesus' mighty name. And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Amen. And amen. Let's give the Lord one more praise. Hallelujah. For deliverance. For victory. Hallelujah. We read here in the story today, and time again, you see in the Word of God that the powers of the unseen world and the demonic activity and unclean spirits and evil spirits that are in this world. You know, it amazes me, people today in the modern church, they want to deny the fact that there is such a thing as demonic spirits in the unseen world. And you know, I can't help but to think today that we're living in a time where the church today, and it maybe falls on the pastors, I don't know, but we've got too many in the church today. They've not been equipped. They've not been enabled by the power of God to understand who the enemy is and learn the tactics of the enemy in the demonic world and the demonic spirits. And I want the people to know today there is an army that is set up. It's set up by the power of Satan, and it's set up by Satan himself. We know today that Satan, he is the opposer of all that is God and all that is of God. He attacks the righteous. He attacks the righteousness of God. He attacks those things that exalts God and those who exalt God. We know the Bible tells us, Jesus said in John 10:10, that the enemy, the thief, he's come to kill. He's come to steal. He's come to destroy. I look around at the things that are happening in this world today. Just last week, I think it was, we saw that a young man walked up into the middle of a schoolhouse, and he killed, I believe it was about 19 people. I think 17 of those were students, young people in that classroom, in that schoolhouse. We're looking at a time today where evil is abounding on every corner, where there is demonic activity and demonic spirits. And we've got a leadership up there in the White House today. We've got a government that can't understand why that we're facing all of these things that we're facing. Why young people are under such attack. They blame it on mental illness and all of these things, and that could be the case. But let me tell you, the church, we ought to not be ignorant of Satan's devices. We know we're not confused. We know what's going on, why these things are happening. It's because of demonic power, demonic spirits, unclean spirits. There's not a doubt in my mind whether we want to deal with it or not. That young man was full of demons. He was possessed by demonic powers. Somebody will say, well, how do you know that? Because you're governed by one of two things. You're either governed by the power of the Holy Ghost, or you're governed by demonic powers and demonic spirits. My friend, there is no in-between ground. You are governed by some spirit. You're either governed by the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit will not call somebody to go into a place like that and do such evil. My friend, today they want to treat everything with psychiatry. They want to treat everything with medicine. They want to treat everything with counseling. Honey, my friend, this is, let me tell you, that's why the church today, and the church would rise up and be what we're supposed to be. There would be less school shootings. There would be less murder. There would be less drug abuse. If the church would rise up, somebody should have got a hold of that young man. a demonic spirit come out of him. Somebody should have told him about the love of Jesus. I pray that the church would rise up to the occasion. The jailhouses wouldn't be as full. The hospitals wouldn't be as full. And demonic spirits wouldn't have the rule and reign like they do today. It's not the president's fault. It's not the government's fault. Judgment must begin at the house of God. And the church is the only function that has the power that we've been equipped with to cast out demons. Demons are real. Evil spirits are real. It's talked about in the Bible. Demonic powers. And you're governed by one of two things. Demons were a part of the angelic realm. They were a part of the angelic being. They were created by God. Somebody say, how do you know that? Because the Bible tells me in Colossians chapter 1 verse 16 that it's by God that all things were created that were in heaven, that are on the earth, things that are visible and things that are invisible, that's seen and unseen, whether they be thrones, whether they be dominions, or whether they be principalities or powers, that's holy angels and fallen angels. All things were created by him and for him. We know the Bible says when Satan was cast out of heaven, he caused a third of that angelic realm to go in their lot with him, and they disobeyed God. And the Bible says that Satan and those third of the angels were kicked out of heaven. My friend, they're here on this earth today. Satan is not like God. He can't be everywhere at one time. So he has an army that is working with him and under his authority and under his power. Honey, let me tell you this morning, you have no authority over Satan outside of Jesus Christ. You have no power over demonic spirits outside of Jesus Christ. I've heard people say, well, I'll take that devil, I'll give him a black eye, and I'll kick him in the shins and do that. Let me tell you something, honey, without the power of the Holy Ghost and without the name of Jesus coming off of your tongue and in your heart, you have no power over Satan and his demonic army. Let me tell you something today. There's only one authority, only one power, and that's in the name that is above every name. The name of Jesus. Hallelujah. So a third of this angelic realm rebelled against God, and they threw their lot in with Satan. When you look at the demonic spirits and their nature, and their nature and their being, they have the same kind of spirit entity as the angels, but they are morally wicked. They are unclean spirits. They are evil spirits. The Bible says that they are full of wickedness and full of darkness. They are deceitful. They are immoral. Now we know that Satan and his angels, his demons, they are able to appear. We know that in Zechariah chapter 3 verse 1, the Bible says that he showed me Joshua the high priest standing before the angel of the Lord, and Satan was standing at his right hand to accuse him. He's the accuser of the brethren. Satan is against you, church. He's against you because you stand for God. He's opposed to God, and he's opposed to the kingdom of God, and Satan does everything. That's why Haley was testifying this week how she's had such a difficult time, because Satan knows that there's an army of God here at Grace Union Church that's been praying for souls to be saved this week, and Satan knows something's getting ready to happen. He knows that things are getting ready to shake loose, and he wants to do everything he can to stand in the way of the work of God. But I'm there today. God has given us power to tread over every serpent, every scorpion. He's given us power over all the enemy. I'm telling you today, he comes before God accusing you that you are nothing. You're not what you say you are. He stands before God, gives an account just like like he did Job. And let me tell you something, my friend. He's the accuser of the brethren. But one of these days, his final fate is going to be thrown into the lake of fire that's burning with brimstone. I want him to hear this old preacher this morning to let him know, hallelujah, he's tormented. He's tortured the people of God. But one of these days, he's going to be tormented forever. Like Satan, these demonic spirits, they have great intelligence. They knew Jesus' identity, and they knew his great authority. Let me tell you this. I want to read something in Luke chapter 9, verse 1. The Bible said Jesus, when he was sending, the 12 were sent for. He called his 12 disciples together. He gave them power. And he gave them authority over all demons and to cure diseases. And the Bible says he sent them to preach the kingdom of God and to heal the sick. My friend, that's the order of ministry. To preach the kingdom of God and heal the sick. Can you say amen? I believe God's still a healer today. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Not only that, but I go to Luke chapter 10. Jesus sends the 74th, and he sends them out to go and preach the gospel. And the Bible says in verse 17, when the 70 returned, they came back with joy, saying, Lord, even the demons are subject unto us through thy name. Hallelujah. And Jesus said, I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven. He said, behold, I give unto you power. I give unto you power. I give unto you power. Honey, don't tell me if you're a child of God and you say, Satan made me do it. He didn't make you do nothing. Hallelujah. Jesus has already given you power over Satan and all the kingdom of darkness. He said, I give unto you power to tread over serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. But even as great as this may be, there's a reason for this. Jesus said, notwithstanding in this, rejoice not that the evil spirits, the unclean spirits, are subject unto you, but rather rejoice because your name is written in heaven. Hallelujah. That's why you've got power and why you've got authority. Somebody ought to praise him today. All the hell may come against you. But you've got the authority of heaven's hosts.
Amen.
Glory to God. Now we come to the story of the Gadarenes and the man that was living and dwelling among the tombs. Jesus and his disciples, they had just crossed over the Sea of Galilee. Just Jesus, he had just rebuked the storm that was on the sea. He had just rebuked and calmed the raging winds that were on the sea. The disciples, you remember, they were shocked and they asked, what man is this man? Who is this man that can calm the winds and the waves, the natural elements of this earth? Who, every place that he stepped his feet, the storm was calm. Every place that he walked on the water, there was no wind, there was no waves of crashing. He could speak, peace be still, and everything had calmed down in the natural realm. Hallelujah. What manner of man is this? But now they were learning more about Jesus as they seen this authority that he had and this power that he had, that it had no limits. Hallelujah. And today I know a lot of people, they portray Jesus as being weak, that he has no power, and that's what most of the church, that's why the world looks at us like we have no influence today, because we portray a weak Jesus. But I'm here to say today, he still has the authority, and there's still no limit to his power. There's still no limit to his authority. You can still speak the name of Jesus, and the storms of life, hallelujah, the winds that rage right around, And now that Jesus had just calmed the natural elements of the world, but now he's getting ready to speak to the storm that's raging in a man's soul. Hallelujah. A man who had been possessed by demonic spirits. It had done got so bad that he was governed by these unclean spirits and evil spirits. And let me say once again, evil spirits are real. The Bible speaks of one, Mary Magdalene, who was healed of evil spirits and sicknesses. The Bible says out of her went seven devils. The Bible says they brought unto Jesus a dumb man. He was possessed with a demon. When Jesus casted out that demon, the dumb man began to speak. In Matthew chapter 12 verse 22, the Bible tells me they brought to Jesus one who was blind and dumb, and he was also possessed with a demon. And the Bible tells me that Jesus healed him. And when Jesus touched him, he could both see and speak. Hallelujah. In Matthew 17, a man came before Jesus who had a son who was an epileptic, and he was greatly vexed by a demonic spirit. And sometimes that demon spirit would throw him into the fire, and sometimes it would throw him into the water. Let me tell you, in the early church, all through the book of Acts, demonic spirits and powers were present, and even down to our present day. Paul said in Ephesians chapter 6 verse 12, we wrestle not against flesh and blood. It's not a natural warfare that we're in. We're not battling against flesh and blood, but we're battling against principalities. We're battling against powers and the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. My friend, that's what we're up against. They go about to remove the good seed. They go about to tempt to be disobedient. They go about to slander the saints of God. They go about to inflict diseases. They go about to oppose those who are righteous. They go to sow the tares among the wheat. They go to ruin the soul and the body and to prey upon men and women. My friend, the demonic spirits are out to tear you to pieces and destroy your home and destroy your life. But I'm telling you, there's one. I said there's one. Hallelujah. Who can calm the storm that rages in your soul and in your home? And his name is Jesus. Glory to God. So now here we have a man. When he crossed over the Sea of Galilee, we have a man who is governed by demonic spirits. I don't know how it happened. I don't know the kind of home that he lived in. I just know that some way, somehow, he had opened up his life to demonic spirits. My friend, that's why you better be careful what you watch.
Amen.
What you see with your eyes, what you hear with your ears, you think it's nothing to listen to this demonic music, country music, and honky tonk music, and rock and roll music. Come on, somebody.
Amen.
You think there's nothing wrong with watching these demonic evil movies on TV. Let me tell you, your eyes are the gateway into your heart and into your mind. Your ears are the gateway into your heart and in your mind. And Satan and his forces, if they can deceive you into believing that I can just do a little bit here and there, my friend, before you know it, before long, you're overtaken by these unclean spirits, and they come in and they find that the heart, the body, has been swept and garnished, that God's not there because you walked away from the Lord. He's not there, and they come in and they bring more with them. It don't start out as one big swift move because Satan and his forces are smarter than that. They're more intelligent than that. But they come in little by little. And the next thing you know, the sin nature begins to grow. And sin begins to grow. And it's infected the body because of the unclean spirit. And I'm telling you, sin is something that will absolutely corrupt your life. It'll destroy you. It'll deteriorize you. Let me tell you something. Sin will take you further than you ever want to go. It'll take leave you longer than you ever want to stay. It'll cost you far more than you ever want to pay. I don't care friend, sin will destroy the life. Sin manipulates you. Sin captivates you. And sin will destroy your life. Somehow this man who had once belonged in society, somehow he, some way he was a pretty outstanding citizen, but he had opened the door for these demonic spirits to come in. And the next thing you know, they governed his mind, they took over his heart, took over his body. The next thing you knew, society didn't even want him around anymore. My friend, sin will isolate you. It'll drive you away from society. You think you've got a part in it, but let me tell you, Satan, he'll have a heyday with your life, because he's out to destroy you. And you need to understand that there's no part of sin in a Christian's life that we ought to partake of. I don't care what it is. You can call it social drinking if you want to, but alcohol has no part in a Christian's life. Pornography has no part in a Christian's life. There's no drug that has a part in a Christian's life. I don't care what it is you're in with. Let me tell you something, my friend. Sin is still sin. I don't care if there ain't a preacher on the face of the earth that don't preach it anymore. You're looking at one that loves you enough to tell you sin will destroy your life, and demonic powers will kill you and destroy you. And if Satan could, he'd put you in the grave. He'd put you in the ground and bury you alive. But for the grace of Almighty God. Isolated from society. They tried to bound him in chains. They tried to bound him in fetters. But he was so governed by demonic spirits and overwhelmed. He would break the chains. He would break the shackles. That's how powerful those demonic spirits are. You ever wonder why it takes about 20 big old buff cops, policemen trying to wrestle one little man ain't no bigger than my pinky finger, trying to wrestle him to the ground, and it takes about 20. They say, oh, he's on drugs. He's on it. Well, he may be, but I tell you what the root of the problem is. He's possessed by demonic spirits, and they're stronger than you are, and outside of the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And so, man, I feel this this morning. I've been waiting here another 2 hours. Lord, have mercy. Somebody, what we get into this morning, I come to see somebody set free.
Amen.
I come to see somebody set this thing loose. Hallelujah. Get free of the devil this morning and get victory and deliverance in your life. My friend, let me tell you this morning, this man, he was so governed by spirits, he was driven out of the town. He went out into the local graveyard, out amongst the tombs. He was dwelling among the dead, but there was something even worse than that. He was hanging out there among the dead corpse in the graveyard, but inside of his soul, because of sin, he was dead in his trespasses and in his sin, like you and I were. You can talk about him if you want to and say, oh, he's a bad man. What about where you were before you were saved? What about where I was before I was saved? I wasn't much different than this man who was possessed with demonic spirits. I had demonic spirits at one time in my life. I was governed by unclean spirits. Alcoholism had took over my life. Drug addiction took over my life. I was so unclean. I couldn't stand people. I hated the church. I hated my family. I hated every preacher that tried to talk to me about the Lord. I had just come out of gospel music, and I was so possessed by demonic spirits. One Sunday morning, glory to God. One Sunday morning, Jesus brought me out of the tombs. He brought me out of the grave, Lord, and set me free. Glory to God. We've all been there. We've all been there before we were saved and born again. We were dead in that spiritual graveyard, dwelling among the spiritually dead. But thanks be to God, the Holy Spirit came by and quickened your mortal body and made you alive. I wish I could get a witness in this place. I wish I had some folks that were saved and raised up their hand and say, that was me. That was me, glory to God. I was dead, governed by the devil and his spirits. But praise God, he showed up. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Jesus goes over this man. I Bible says he was so overwhelmed by the powers of the demonic spirits. But something happened when that boat pulled up and Jesus stamped his foot, Brother Teddy, out on the shore.
Amen.
I believe when Jesus got out of that boat, I believe all the hell began to shake.
Yep.
I believe their demonic spirits' knees began to tremble, because they knew here was the one who was incarnated. Hallelujah. Here's the one that wasn't conceived by natural means, but he was born of a virgin. Hallelujah. Yes. He was conceived by the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
I believe that legion who is many, he said, hallelujah, that's a term, that's a Latin term for an army of about 6,000 troops. You know that this man may have been possessed by as many as 6,000 demons, demonic spirits. But let me tell you something, my friend, I don't care how great the bondage might be.
Amen.
I said, I don't care how great that yoke of bondage, how great the iron furnace you might be in. I don't care how big the chain might be. When Jesus gets out of the boat and steps on the shore, hallelujah, all the hell begins to tremble. And all the hell is put on notice, hallelujah. This man, them demons said, here he is, the Son of God. And he came up to him, and you know, everybody thought, why in the world does Jesus want to fool with this man? Because Jesus said, I came to seek and to save that which was lost. The religious leaders and much of the modern church today, I've had people tell me, why you want to go down there in downtown Louisville? Those people are crazy. They're insane. Why don't you want to go down there and minister to them folks? I said, because I'm no different than they were. They need the same gospel message that I needed to hear one day. Their souls are precious, just as precious in the eyes of God as my soul was. Hallelujah. They need deliverance. They need victory in their life. They need a breakthrough. I'm telling you, my friend, much of the religious leaders, they would say, Jesus, why do you want to fool with people like that? He would tell them, I didn't come to call the righteous, but that the sinners come to repentance. Hallelujah. He didn't come to make everybody wealthy. He didn't come just to make everybody, hallelujah, feel good. He came that souls, that the chains and the shackles and the bondages of Satan, he came, hallelujah. That's why 1 John 3:8 says, this is why Jesus appeared. Hallelujah. That the power of Satan would be broken. Hallelujah. And he got out there, and then demonic spirits, they recognized Jesus. How many in the church even recognizes Jesus? Think about that. Even the demons recognized who he was. Hallelujah. And they begged him not to send them back down to the abyss, but to let them go into that herd of swine. And Jesus cast them out into that herd of swine. They were begging Jesus not to cast them out. They knew in just a few weeks. You listen to me. They knew just in a few weeks that this very one they were standing before, he was going to go to a hill called Calvary. And they were going to lift him up between heaven and earth on that old cross and drive nails through his hands and through his feet. And they knew at that moment when Jesus would be on that cross, that would be the moment that he would disarm every demonic spirit. He would disarm all of hell. Hallelujah. He would disarm Satan, and he would no longer have authority and power over humanity. But Jesus would break the back of every demonic spirit on Calvary's hill. Hallelujah. And he did it when he died on that cross, and he made the show of them open and triumphing over them. And if somebody ought to shout this morning,
he
come to hurt you, come to help you today. And victory in the name of Jesus. And so that herd of swine got possessed. They went off down that hillside into the sea. And all those herdsmen out there, you know, you always got that crowd.
Yeah. Amen.
You always got that crowd of skeptics and always talking about something. Well, you know, Jesus just casted them out by the power of Beelzebub. It wasn't real. Let me tell you something, blaspheming the Holy Ghost. The unpardonable sin. Somebody said, what is blasphemy? It's when you give the devil credit for what God has done.
Amen. Amen.
Let me say it one more time. Blasphemy is when you give the devil credit for what God has done.
That's right.
Amen.
Hallelujah. And they accused Jesus, and they saw their herd of swine. They thought more of their finances. They thought more of their property than they did getting eternal life when it was standing right there in front of them. But they could not deny the testimony of the man who was once in the tomb. Bound by fetters and chains, bound by the demonic spirits, naked, running around out of his mind. But when they looked and saw this one that had stepped on the shore, the one who had power not just over the natural elements, but he had power over the soul of man in the storm that rages, and he can speak peace to your soul this morning. I said he can speak peace to your soul this morning. Hallelujah. I know they tell me after 30 minutes of preaching, people turn you off. That's all right with me. I don't see that in the Bible nowhere. Hallelujah. Let me tell you this morning, he still has the power and the authority to speak peace in your life and give you victory and break every chain. And some folks today, they can't even worship God. They're so wrapped up and bound by the devil. But honey, if you just start shaking them things off, shaking them chains off, shake it off, hallelujah.
Amen.
Shake that thing off in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Get free, hallelujah. Amen. They looked and they saw this man who once was possessed by demons. They said he was there sitting at the feet of Jesus.
Amen.
Clothed and in his right mind.
Amen.
Oh, somebody don't shout. That'd make a dead Presbyterian shout. I can talk about the Presbyterians. I used to pastor one. I come to Presbyterian. Hallelujah. That'll make a dead cold Baptist shout.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Because I remember one time when I was naked in my shame, spiritually speaking. Hallelujah. I had no mind. I was just full of insanity. I was full of the devil and all his powers. But one Sunday morning, I can tell you the time. I can take you to the place. And if I began to look a little crazy, Brother Terry, when I began to talk about my experience with the Lord, see, this man, he had just received brand new life. The Bible tells me in 2 Corinthians 5:17, if any man or woman be in Christ, if they're born again and saved, hallelujah, they've been set free and delivered, they are a brand new creation in Christ. Things have passed away, and behold, all things have become new. My friend, I don't hold on to nothing in my past. I'm not looking back there in my past. I'm forgetting those things that are behind me, and I'm reaching forward to those things that are before me. I took off the old man, and I put on the new man. I was born July 22nd, 2007, hallelujah. That Sunday morning, somebody said, what happened? That's a day I'll never forget. As long as I live, I had a birth I can't remember. But praise God, I had one I'll never forget, hallelujah. That Sunday morning, I walked into the church house doors over in Little Summersville, Kentucky. And I'm sure a lot of people said, there's no hope for him. He's gone way out there. They looked at me, took one look at me, at the greasy head that I had then, and how that I looked, and all the, I mean, I'm not got another inch long hair, but I'm talking about the way I looked. Long beard and long hair. Never took care of myself. Now, I wouldn't mind having long hair, but I was the only keep took good care of. Our brother back here, his wife jumped on him and made him cut his hair instead. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. But I'm talking about I didn't even care about my own life. Didn't care about myself. Just let it go. Hallelujah. But I walked in that morning. I'm sure there was some of that religious crowd. Oh, there's no way. What's he doing here in this place? There's no way. But let me tell you something. God likes to work when nothing else will. And folks will tell you there's no way. God's standing on the hallelujah. Standing in the heavens saying, I'm going to make a way. I'm going to bring you victory. I'm going to let the blood of Jesus wash over you and cleanse you from every stain of sin. Hallelujah. I tell you, that morning I walked in. I didn't care. I got to the place. Didn't care what the people thought. But when invitation time come, all I knew is I needed something in my life. I was empty of something. I was void of something. But that morning, hallelujah, I don't know how it happened, but I just stepped down in that aisle. And let me tell you something. I don't even remember the rest of the way there. And to be honest with you, I don't even remember kneeling down praying. I don't remember what I said, Jackson. I don't remember kneeling down. But I remember coming up. I remember coming up, glory to God. And when I came up, glory to God, I've not been the same since. Hallelujah. He brought me out. And now I'm sitting at the feet of Jesus. Because I know me better than anybody else. I'm in my right mind. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Not only that, I'm getting ready to close. But I'm going to tell you, listen, when Jesus changes you, and you get new life, and you've got deliverance, and you've got that breakthrough, and the shackles are fell to the ground, and the chains are broken, honey, I don't see how you can keep quiet about it.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
Praise God.
I said, I don't see how you can keep quiet about it.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I heard a man say the other day, I've never met a Christian who was ever sorry.
Amen.
I met a few sorry Christians, but I've never met one who's been born again that was ever sorry that they was ever saved and born again and received new life.
Amen.
Let me tell you something. New life means just that, new life. You're not going to claim to be saved and go back out the very next day to continue living under the bondage of the sin nature. I don't care what you say, what you believe, it ain't about what you feel and your opinion about the Word of God. If you're a brand new creation in Christ, that's just what you are. I'm not talking about failing the Lord and messing up, but I'm talking about your whole lifestyle is a lifestyle of sin and bound by the sin nature. Let me tell you something, honey, you get a true dose of this salvation, you get truly born again, washed in the blood of the Lamb. We either believe the Bible or we don't. When you get it, hallelujah. Hallelujah. The Bible tells me you're a new man. You took off the old man and you put on the new man. Hallelujah. Let me tell you something. You don't have a desire to do the things you used to do. And let me tell you one thing about it. When God truly touches you, you won't be able to keep quiet about it. You have to tell everybody. That man went back into the city. He told everybody what happened to him. He said, I was that man out there in the tomb. I was that man who was dead. I was that man who hung out with the corpse. But now I've been clothed. I'm standing at the feet of Jesus. I'm in my right mind.
Amen.
Well, I sound like the Samaritan woman. We talked about Wednesday night. People go against women preachers. She preached the first message in the Word of God.
Amen.
She went back into the town preaching, saying, come see a man.
Amen.
He told me all things I ever did.
Yep. Amen.
Let me tell you, hallelujah. And we talk Wednesday night. You won't keep women silent. You try your best to do it. Hallelujah. Let me get out of the way. Let me tell you something. You can say what you want to, but it ain't about your feelings either.
That's right.
It's about what the Word of God says. She went back into the town and proclaimed. She said, come see a man. Here was a woman bound by demonic spirits and the powers of darkness. Honey, when God touches you and gets a hold to you, when he steps out of that boat and puts his foot on the shore, Jackson, I'm telling you, you'll never be the same again. When he touches you, you'll never be the same again. Hallelujah. as she went to the well looking to get some water.
Yeah.
But what she found was everlasting life.
Yeah.
What she found was an eternal well. Oh, glory to God. Hallelujah. And you don't keep a silence.
Amen.
Glory to God. Hallelujah. Grace the Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah. What about you this morning? What about you? You can say, well, everything's all right. And inside you'll be so broken. You can fool me. You can fool a lot of people. But you can't fool God.
Amen.
Amen.
Everything's open and naked before His eyes. And let me tell you, one of these days you're going to have to do with Him. And you're going to have to stand before Him. And you're going to have to get things right somewhere along the way.
Amen.
You may be here bound. You may be here oppressed and depressed. But God can deliver you.
Amen.
I said God can deliver you.
Amen.
And bring victory in your life. Hallelujah. Satan has no power over a child of God.
Amen.
Only what you give.
Amen.
Let's stand all over this building, every head bowed, every eye closed. And I'm just believing today somebody needs victory in this house. People always tell me, say, well, you're preaching right at me. I'm not preaching right at anybody. It's the Spirit of God that's speaking to you. And today, if you need deliverance, this is your day. Why go any longer bound? Why go any longer with those grave clothes on? Why live any longer governed by the powers of darkness? Honey, Satan will deceive you and tell you you're getting along just fine without the Holy Spirit. But God's sending this word to you today, telling you you won't make it in this life nor the life to come. And the only reason you got this far, thus far, is because of His grace. This morning, God wants to make it right in your life. Why dwell any longer among the tombs, among the dead? God is the God of life. He wants to give it and give it more abundantly. This morning, if you need victory, let me tell you something. I wouldn't worry about what somebody thinks of you. I wouldn't worry about what somebody might say. I'd be more concerned of God's thoughts and what His Word declares about me. I'm going to ask this one simple question and we're going to pray. Is everything all right in your life? Is everything all right in your heart? Heavenly Father, I come before You in Jesus' name. I thank You and praise You for Your Word that we can stand on. That it's not a matter of opinions or feelings, but God, it's a matter of the promises You've declared in Your Word. God, I thank You today that You have authority and You have power over all the enemy. And Lord, I don't know why You sent this message this way today, but I know there has to be a reason. And God, if there's one in here today that needs deliverance, that needs salvation, that needs victory, God, I pray with all that I have, give them that option to step out in faith and a holy boldness. Help them, give them the courage, Lord, to step out, that they would have that experience like they've never had before, nor will they ever. That born-again experience. But Lord, I thank You today that, Lord, You made a way that we don't have to die and spend eternity in hell. That awful, awful place of torment. But God, You made a way through the blood of Your Son, Jesus, that all men can be saved and set free. God, move in this place, and I pray for those, Lord, that are hungry for a move of the Holy Spirit in their life. I pray, Lord, this very moment that you would sweep through as a mighty rushing wind in their soul. And God, that you would use a mighty word. And Lord, that it would be so much of God in their life, there's no room for anything else. Ask these things in Jesus' name. If there's any here that need a closer walk with the Lord, I want you to step out of that aisle, make your way to this altar. Let me folks pray with you. Nobody's here to embarrass anybody. Even right now, don't hesitate, don't wait. If you're hungry for a move of God in your life, step out. If you need to pray for anything, step out. As we say. Put her name for that, Tracy. Put her name for that. Jesus' name, I pray you meet those needs that they have. And God shield him from all the adversary, every enemy that would try to destroy him. In Jesus' name, he loves you this morning. God, hold him up by your right hand. Thank you, Lord.
Get up here in front to see that.
enthusiasm on Sunday mornings, it does something to me. Makes the little kid inside of me, Jackson, come out and scream. Boy, ain't God good.
Oh,
ain't God good. And he brought you through a mighty long way.
Oh,
yeah. And he been good to you. But we're very fat, we just won't go out on this praise of the Lord. Let one mighty God we serve. Let one mighty God we serve. Over at Breakthrough Ministries.